writer, political commentator, and columnist. She writes for several news portals and has been a columnist for Daily News and Analysis, otherwise known as DNA, an Indian-based newspaper published from Mumbai, India. Her bylines have appeared in the Houston Chronicle, Denver Post, Indian Express, Economic Times, Swarajya, and many others. Her area of focus has been conflict-ridden state of Jammu and Kashmir, and she has written extensively, covering all aspects of the conflict that is considered one of the most volatile conflicts in the most volatile regions in South Asia. In 2019, she represented the Kashmiri Hindu voice and addressed the human rights situation in Kashmir at the U.S. Congress Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission. In a testimony that went viral, she was the first to talk about Kashmiri Hindus and their genocide in the United States Congress. Please give a round of applause to Sunanda Vashisht.
Thank you so much. Thank you for everyone who's here today. Sorry, the long drive from Houston makes one a bit thirsty. Thank you. Good evening. I am delighted to be here. Post-pandemic, this is my very first in-person speaking engagement, and I'm glad it is in this wonderful institution of UT Austin, where there's so much scholarship, such wonderful people, and a lot of debate that generates here. What do people like me want? Debate and conversations. That's all we are talking, we're here about. So I would like to thank Hindu YUVA organizations, these young men and women, and especially Vishwajit, who got in touch with me and convinced me to drive 4 hours in traffic. Thank you so much. I would have done it anyway, but thank you so much. Jumping straight into what we're talking about, the topic for today's talk is Kashmiri Hindu genocide. It should actually have been forgotten genocide of Kashmiri Hindus. And in the next course of 40-45 minutes, I will try to tell you a brief history of Kashmir, Hindus of Kashmir, and why I think you need to understand that history in order to understand the exodus of 1989-90 and the ethnic cleansing, the genocide that led to the ethnic cleansing, only ethnic cleansing that has happened in post-independent India, and only mass exodus that has happened in post-independent India. Most of us, after right now, this is for about 32 years, the story is about 32 years old, well, about 700 years old, but 32 years old as the current crisis. And for the longest time, we have not been heard. The whole allegation that you have not spoken is wrong. The real story is that we've not been heard. And now finally the movie, The Kashmir Files, is out, and there was this testimony that Suresh talked about. Thank you so much for graciously introducing me. After that, there has been some debate. And I think and mostly when I go to talk about Kashmir situation, I usually focus on 1989-90 and post after that, because that is where all my research is, where my training is. But today I felt we should do something different, because this is a university environment and all of you are young students who will be starting your lives and you're grappling with new ideas. Today I thought I will tell you a story of 700 years quickly and tell you that what happened in 1989-90 cannot be viewed in isolation. It cannot be seen as a one-off event. this is not how I was trained to look at my own story. I'm a Kashmiri Hindu, as you all mostly know. This is not how I was trained. This is not how any of the people in my generation or generation previous to me or before that were trained. We were not trained to look at our stories as in scholarly, you know, we have not been trained to look at our story for 700 years. But it's strange that in our language, in the way we talk to each other, in our songs, even though history has forgotten us, in our little folk songs, in our languages, in our idioms, in our phrases, this 700 year old history keeps coming up again and again and again. And if you pay attention, you will know that we all have what I call civilizational memory. We all are born with civilizational memory, even though history books may have forgotten about it, history books may not have not told us, but our civilizational memory stayed with us. And it is that memory that I would like to awaken in you today, so that you can see this whole story, the thread that flows from 1339 to 2022 CE, and see why we need to address the Kashmiri Pandit issue and the genocide of Kashmiri Pandit issue in this manner. When I say Kashmir, what is traditionally that comes to your mind? Beautiful, natural beauty. Those of you who are my age, maybe Yash Chopra's films, and Kashmir Ki Kali, or people who were born and raised here, Kashmir, sweater, beautiful. That's what is traditionally that comes to mind. But what is Kashmir associated with right now? It is associated with terrorism, violence. It is the geopolitical hotspot in the world. It's trouble torn. In fact, President Clinton once said that potentially, if Third World War were to begin, it could begin from Kashmir, because two nuclear countries have gone to war on Kashmir for 4 years. I mean, four wars they have fought with each other. So it's not like Kashmir was not in news. Kashmir has always been in news. What has not been in news is his Kashmiri Hindus. The aboriginals of Kashmiri Hindus have not been in news. But otherwise, you have always heard about Kashmir. Just anybody who is a student of international relations, or a student of journalism, or a student of political science, you've always heard about Kashmir. You have just not heard about Kashmiri Pandits. And first of all, let me just tell you who are, because there's a lot of confusion about this also. Kashmir, as most people know, it is in the north of India. And now this is the latest map, which was released by Government of India on August 5th, 2019, after the reorganization was done. Notice Ladakh and notice Jammu and Kashmir. The reason I'm showing you this map is, look at how small Jammu and Kashmir is. And here we are only talking about, we're not talking about Ladakh, we're not talking about Jammu, we are talking about Kashmir. And within Kashmir also, we are talking about the trouble-torn places, that is only 4 or 5 districts. So it's these 4 or 5 districts that have held the entire world at ransom. So it's important to understand the geography as well. So who are Kashmiri Pandits? Kashmiri Pandits and Kashmiri Hindus can be used interchangeably. These are aboriginals of Kashmir Valley. Their recorded history is 5,000 years old. The almanac, the calendar that we follow, that you will see in every Kashmiri Pandit's house, we call it Jantari. All all Hindu communities, as you would know, follow a Hindu calendar. Kashmiri Hindus also follow a calendar, but it's different from the other calendars. It is called Saptarishi Samvat, and it is 5,000. Currently, we are in 5,098th year. This is what it looks like. The Jantri today looks like this. This is where we find our you know, festivals, birthdays that we celebrate according to the lunar calendar. This is where we find all this. This calendar has been made year after year after year for 5,000 years. It's the only functional calendar that is that old. In India, it's usually Vikrami Samvat or Shak Samvat, but Saptarishi Samvat is only Kashmiri Hindu. So that tells you that it is an unbroken chain of 5,000 years. According to the legend, and this I just heard actually this legend, that Saptarishi, seven rishis, seven celestial rishis of Hinduism, they once convened at a place called Hari Parvat, which is in Srinagar. Hari Parvat is also Sharika Parvat. She is the eight-armed goddess who is the presiding deity of Kashmir Valley. When the first beam of sunlight touched her as an obeisance, the sun god was paying obeisance to mother goddess Sharika, and that is when it was calculated that it's the beginning of the Saptarishi era. So today, as I said, we are in 5098 year. So during this 5,000 year unbroken journey, Kashmiri Hindus or Pandits, they have made immense contributions to the world of literature, music, philosophy. You must have often heard that Indian politicians or Indian, you know, a lot of people in India say that Kashmir is an integral part of India. And a lot of you must have dismissed it as rhetoric. You know, this is political rhetoric. Kashmir is part of India? What does that mean? After all, India was only made in 1947. How many of you think that India came into existence in 1947? Raise your hand. Wow, this is a wonderful audience. Because if I go and ask the same question anywhere else, in a classroom in India for sure, everybody will tell me India was born in 1947. There was no India before 1947, because that is what we are taught in our history books, right? That there was no India before 1947, there was nothing. So when I sort of divide Indians, I usually tell people that there are two kinds of people in India right now. People who believe that India was born in 1947 and people who don't believe India was born in 1947. And it's people who don't believe in 1947, they've created all kinds of problems. Because then they have to find these, you know, linkages. They have to say that Kashmir was part of India or was not part of India. They have to rely on Indian Constitution, Article 370 and all these things to say that India was part of, Kashmir was part of India, not looking at the cultural and the civilizational aspect of it. So today it is very important to, for you to understand that from the beginning, the formation of the present Asian continent, Kashmir has remained the inseparable part of India. So geographically and culturally and civilizationally, Kashmir has never been separate from India. How many of you have heard of Kalidas? How many of you knew that he is a Kashmiri? He's a Kashmiri poet. Yeah. You do? That's wonderful. I expected you to know. I didn't expect her to know. That's wonderful. Kalidas, in his Kumar Sambhavam, he wrote, and I translated, his first verse is, "The paramount Himalayas in the north, extending from east to west, stand unshakable in its glory." That's how his poem starts. So he clearly knew the geography of India. So when anybody tells you that there was no political India before 1947, you must always tell them that there is this, India is a civilizational state. So in a civilizational state, everybody knew the borders. Everybody knew the borders of India. Everybody knew from the Himalayas to the oceans. Everybody knew that this is the Bharat Sabhyata, Bharatiya Sabhyata, Indian civilization. So who were people who were living in India? Who were some of the celebrities who lived in Kashmir at that time? Kalidas, Shir Swami, Kalhan, Raj Tanvi, you must have heard, and I'm going to refer to Raj Tanvi a lot of times in my presentation. Abhinav Gupt, Acharya Abhinav Gupt. Shailendra, Rojanak. So these are people, Panini, these are people who have really created Indian civilization. It's because of them that we know Indian civilization the way we know. Therefore, when people say that Kashmir is the cradle of Indian civilization, it's not rhetoric. It is a fact. It is a fact that is borne by real incidents that Kashmir is truly the civilizational belt, civilizational cradle of India. So then what happened after that? The persecution of Kashmiri Hindus began with the Islamic conquest of Kashmir. And since then, we have recorded 7 exoduses. This is not the first exodus. 7 exoduses that have happened in last 700 years, the latest being one in 1989, of which I am personally a victim. Let me give you a bit of statistic. What is 7 exoduses in 700 years? 7 exoduses in 700 years mean that every 100 years there was an exodus. Every 100 years there was an exodus, which means that every third generation of Kashmiri Pandits have seen an exodus. Tell me, is there any other community in the world? Is there any other group in the world, Jews included, that have seen persecution this extent? And my endeavor today would be to tell you that the first exodus and the 7th exodus, they are really, there is a thread going through all of them. They are not different from each other. Because it's very important to understand that. And it's very important to understand that our history cannot begin where we are told it begins. So, the genocide that we speak of from 1339 to 2022, which is continuing, because there is denial of, as long as genocide is denied, genocide continues. This continuous genocide is rather, the correct word is continual genocide, because we have seen periods of peace in between. Kashmir forever, for last 700 years, peace in Kashmir has meant time period between two violent eras. The definition of peace in Kashmir is that between two violent eras, when you have a small breather, a small, peaceful time, that is known as a period of peace. So in last 7 years, so during these periods of peace, we may have seen some respite, but this has been a continual genocide. And this is why the events of 1990 cannot be seen in isolation. So what is the first? I'll quickly go through these 7 exoduses and then I will spend some time on 1989-90. First exodus was in AD 1339. This is when Islamic dynasty, Islamic rule was established in Shahiri dynasty, and Islamic rule was established in Kashmir. This was done after defeating the last queen, Kota Rani. And how was she defeated? Through foul means. And who defeated her? A man called Shahmir, who had come from Swat Valley. The same Swat Valley that is known for Panini and all these places. Where I said Panini had initially come from. How did Shahmir come to Kashmir? Did he defeat the kings of Kashmir? That would have been honorable. If he had come and defeated the kings, that would have been an honorable defeat. He did not come as a, he did not come to defeat. He came as a refugee, and as a refugee, he sought, as has happened everywhere in India, Hindu kings have given refuge because that is the culture, that is how Bharatiya Sabhyata is. He was given refuge. He lived at the court, and through some foul means, he overturned the throne and installed himself on the throne. So thus began the Shahmiri dynasty, the 22 kings after that. So this was in 1939. This was the first time that diktats came to be given to Kashmiri Hindus, Kashmiri Pandits. Why this is important to know? Because you also have to understand the most important prism of understanding Kashmiri Hindus is the prism of demographics. Most of you will ask me a question that why did you not stay back and why did you not fight back? This is a question that normally people ask. And it's a very valid question. And I tell them that, well, we were only 2%, 3% of the population, at that time 5% of the population, there was no way we could fight back. But the bigger question that has never been asked to me till now, and I hope some of you after today ask this question, that why did this demographics of 100% of Kashmiri Pandits become 5% and now currently not even 1%? Because through those depleting demographics, you will know the story of Kashmir. Why is it, how is it that 100% population in 700 years becomes just 5% of what they were? So the diktat that I was talking about during the Shahi time, he understood that to rule this place now, I cannot, he was in minority at that time, obviously. He had come with just a band of followers and he was in minority. He knew that he has to somehow find himself more followers, or he has to find some acceptance in the society, and he knew he would not find the acceptance otherwise, so the only acceptance was conversion. So the conversion started full time in 1339, once Shahi dynasty was established. So initially it was just the diktats that Muslim rulers shall not allow the construction of Hindu temples for the first time. And shrines, they will not allow constructions of temples and shrines for image worship. No repair shall be executed to existing Hindu temples. This is all documented, by the way. Everything I'm telling you today is documented, and this is even accepted by the historians, the modern historians, who typically throw away Hindu history because they think that it does not pass the rigor. But this passes the rigor because it is in Rajtarangani. Rajtarangani passes the rigor. It's the only history of ancient India that passes rigor of the modern historians. They may not refer to it, but they at least acknowledge it, because it's a critical view. It's not a hagiography of kings, which was mostly, you know, at that time, that's what courtiers used to do. But Rajtarangani is not a hagiography of kings. And Rajtarangani was not just written by Kalan. There was a Dvitiya Rajtarangani written by Jona Raja. Then there was third Rajtarangani, fourth Rajtarangani. We only know first Rajtarangani by Kalan, which was famous. So all this is in Rajtarangani, written very well. And there are translations available, which I have read. So there was, Hindus cannot, and at that time the diktats were, as I told you, first thing about the temples, idol worship. Hindus shall not ride a harnessed horse, because at that time we used to ride a horse. They shall not move about with arms. Remember the time we are talking about. So they shall not move with arms. I found an interesting one. They shall not wear diamond in their rings. You know, things like those diktats. They shall not exhibit idolatrous images. So no showing of God's images. Another important thing at that time, because a lot of people at this time, now that Islam had come into Kashmir, a lot of other people, remember at this time Islam had already come to Sindh. So now there were people coming from all these sides, and they said that there is a Islamic rule in Kashmir, so a lot of Sufis and Darveshes and, you know, travelers used to come. So diktat was passed that no Muslim traveler shall be refused lodging in the Hindu temples and shrines, where he shall be treated as guests. No problem shall be created for those non-Muslims who of their own will show the readiness to accept Islam. This we're talking about in 1339, 1340, that time. The dress of Muslims and Hindus should be different. These were the diktats that were passed by things. Later in the presentation, when I talk to you about genocide and how modern scholars of genocide talk about classification and all these things, the pointers they give about why a certain incident or a certain set of situations can be called a genocide, you will see a thread right from this time, 1339, onwards. You will see that there are things happening. There is symbolization or all those things that you will see. Just keep in mind what I'm telling you, that all these things that are happening, they will come back to you when we're talking about how modern scholars or how modern people, they look at genocide. So at this time, slowly all the temples in Srinagar, including ones at Vijayawada, which was a very important center, these were wrecked. And the idea was terrorize one and get rid of five, which is again another thread which continues till now. Kill one and 10 others will be scared. So that thread has been continuing. Shahmir was followed by Sikandar Shah. He is still known, as I told you, that our history and in our folklore and in our songs and in our daily language, we use that. Sikandar Butshikan is a name that every Hindu must have. What does Butshikan mean? His name was Sikandar Shah. Butshikan means the destroyer of idols. And this is what everyone, they called him Sikandar Butshikan. And this is what even my grandmother would say these things. She may not have known the history, but even she knew about the existence of Sikandar Butshikan. Because he perpetrated such cruelty on people, on the residents of Kashmir, on this group of people who had not yet become minority, by the way. Till 1450, the lingua franca of Kashmir was Sanskrit. Till 1450 even though Islamic rule began in 1339, till 1450, the court language and everything was still Sanskrit, because that's what the majority of people spoke. Once I had gone to Haridwar and I met, just an aside, and I met a sadhu, anyone of you have gone to Haridwar, I met a sadhu there, and I told him, he said, they asked me in India, where are you from? So I said, I am from Kashmir. And the minute they hear you are from Kashmir, and they, you know, they sort of look at you with a certain thing, and they say, and he told me at that point, he said, and I translated for you, he said to me in Hindi, he said, ek zamane mein कश्मीर के बच्चे ऐसी संस्कृत बोलते थे कि काशवी के विद्वान शर्मा जाते थे, which meant at one point the kids in Kashmir would speak such perfect, beautiful Sanskrit that the pundits or the teachers in Kashi, which is Banaras, would just be wondering, you know, be amazed. So this was lingua franca till 1450. This is what an ordinary person in Haridwar told me. So this has continued, and now things obviously have changed a lot from Sanskrit to this thing, but this is where we have come from. So this is what Sikandar Butshikan was treating. He had not yet, he was still dealing with a majority that was not of his faith. So what did he do? The fanaticism and the bigotry that he unleashed is something that will put perhaps Hitler to shame. And we never talk about, when we talk about Hitler and we talk about Pol Pot and we talk about Stalin, we never talk about these people, because somehow it has been given a miss in the history, world history. But Sikandar Butshikan could easily occupy an infamous spot in that group of now terrorists and at that time, despots. Jola Raja, the guy I told you who wrote the second Rajatarmini, in fact, he has given the details of genocide so clearly. And in fact, there is a research right now going on about his work, because Jola Raja is not even known that much. And he has actually explained the genocide that happened at the time of Sikandar Butshikan. And he calls it Jati Vidmas. I was shocked. I just heard about this a month ago. Somebody who was studying Jona Raja, I don't study, unfortunately, I don't read Sanskrit very well, so I have to rely on translations. But a gentleman who reads and who's studying this and who's actually going to have a very scholarly paper out pretty soon, Jona Raja talked about genocide in 1413. His name was different. He called it Jati because he called extermination of a Jati. Extermination of an entire group of people, which is what we know as genocide. So Jona Raja was talking about it then. He says, and I quote him, "The Sultan forgot his kingly duties and took delight day and night in breaking images. He broke images of Mardand, Vishya, Ishana, Chakrabit, Tripureshwar. These are our gods. There were no city, no town, no village where Turushka left the temples of the gods unbroken." End quote. Turushka, Turks were known as Turushka. So he was, because there was some Turkish descent in this Shahri dynasty, so he calls them in his book, he calls them Turushka. So he says that there was no temple that he did not vandalize. Sun temple, Marathard, which was first built by Ramakrishna and then rebuilt by the greatest king of Kashmir, you might not have heard his name, Lalit Aditya. His empire was bigger than Ashoka's empire and Akbar's empire at one point. But obviously our history doesn't tend to be very favorable to him. He had rebuilt this sun temple of Marathand, and it took 1 year for Sikandar Butshikan to destroy it. He could still not destroy it, even after 1 year. So what he did was he took out the stones and he put wood in the stones, wherever the stones were, because it was a stone structure, because it was not getting destroyed completely. So he told his people to replace the stones at the structure, at the basic what on which it stood, with wood, and then burn it. Even after that, he could not burn it. The ruins still remain. I have been to Marathand. If any of you ever go to Kashmir, please go and visit Marathand. Take off your shoes and do pranams to the god, sun temple there. Don't do what Hindi cinema did, which is what Haider, Vishal Bhardwaj in Haider did. He called it Shaitan Ki Gufa and did that dance number of Satan there. If any of you have watched the movie, it is not Shaitan Ki Gufa, it is not Satan's cave, it is our temple. If any of you ever go to Kashmir, please go and pay obeisance to King Lalit Aditya and to the ruins of Marathand, because this is our history. So during Sikandar Butshikan's time. Before him, when his father and grandfather, small tribes, small groups were leaving. But the first massive exodus was in his time. This was the first disastrous mass exodus which left the state. They're saying about 50% of the people left at that time in Sikandar Butshikan's reach. Then the second exodus happened during Ali Shah, his son. He's called Ali Shah the Tyrant. He ruled from 1413 to 1430. He carried on his father's tyranny with homicides, conversions, and enforced jizya. Jizya is a system, taxation system, where if you want to live in Islamic society, if you want to live, you have to pay a tax to the king, and it's called jizya. So Sikandar Butshikan had already started that jizya where people would pay to stay alive. So this jizya was increased now in the second time. It is this draconian rule. At that time, since people had started fleeing, what he did, he was such an evil man. And we don't talk about him when we talk about, as I said, if we talk about Stalin and Hitler and all these people, but he would put his people at any of the places where He knew that Kashmiri Pandits were escaping. He would put his people there, and if they were escaping, they would be brought back to his court and they would be killed. Some of the Hindus at that time, they killed themselves by taking poison. Some tied the rope around themselves and drowned themselves. Others fell off the precipice on their own. A multitude of very learned Brahmins from Kashmir at this time, who had fled through the by roads as the main roads were closed, they went all the way to Karnataka, to what is now Tamil Nadu, to Madhya Pradesh. A lot of, I found some people there. So these were people who moved at that time, who fled at that time. This was such a miserable mass exodus that Jona Raja calls it Chandadand, violent, cruel, brutal punishment for the Hindus of Kashmir at that time. Then third round of exodus happened in Shamsuddin Iraqi. I don't know how many of you have known Shamsuddin Iraqi, but there are two branches of Islam, as some of you might know. There is a Sunni branch and there is a Shia branch. So Sunni branch, all the Shamir dynasty and all that, they were Sunni rulers. Shamsuddin Iraqi had come from Iran. He was of Nurbakh Shia order, Shia sect in Kashmir. His mission was vicious propagation of faith, conversion at all costs. He did it along with another converted Hindu at that time, whose name was Malik Musa Rehna. Together, the two of them, the amount of fanaticism and the amount of bigotry and the amount of violence that was wreaked in is now written in books, and these books can be found in Iran. In Iran, a lot of scholars have gone and they have found in their rooms, they have found the, you know, the treachery and the cruelty with which people were converted at that time to Shia sect. So when it came to Kashmiri Hindus, it did not matter whether it was a Sunni sect or the Shia sect. It was, both sides were trying to convert. So there is a very strong Shia community in Kashmir this time. This is when they were converted at that time. It's said that around 24,000 of them were forcibly converted at that time. Look at what the populations were at that time. Their sacred threads were removed. Kalima was administered to them, and they were all circumcised, and the men were circumcised and made to eat beef. Those who stayed back, those who did not flee, were forced to pay jizya, or their noses and ears were cut off. And to escape this terror, Hindus used to hide themselves, and there is a phrase that is still used in Kashmiri families to this day. It's called nabatto ham, my grandmother used to say, my grandfather used to say this, and used to tell us the stories. Nabatto ham, that means I am not a Hindu. Kashmiri Pandits with each other, they don't call themselves Pandits. We don't call each other Pandits. Or even the word Hindu is not very prevalent when we talk each other. We call each other as Bhatta. Bhatta means a teacher, a learned teacher, or a Brahmin, or a somebody who is involved in the teaching of scriptures. He is Bhatta. So these people, they used to call themselves Nabatto Ham. For the longest time, I had heard this in my head, but I did not know where this comes from. Nabatto Ham comes from this one. Iraqi's time. Then, of course, we move on to fourth exodus, which was when Aurangzeb had ascended the throne. Again, the same bigoted, fanatic, and dogmatic approach. His Mughal governor, Iftikhar Khan, he started this whole reign of violence and in those terms, now we would call it terrorism, and conversions. And by this time, the demographics, the population is getting depleted. It's already from 100% to, by this time, we are already on 25%. So whenever anybody asks, why didn't you stay back and fight? This is the story. We were fighting. This is the time some of you might have heard about Kashmiri Pandits going to Guru Tegh Bahadur and asking for refuge. And Guru Tegh Bahadur said, okay, go tell the Mughal ruler that if he can convert me, then everybody else will, you will also get converted. Then of course the whole story is known to everybody. And you will find Guru Tegh Bahadur is very revered in many Hindu poems in Kashmir till this day, Hindu Pichal as he is known. But this is the story. This happened at that time. He stopped some migration. Then fifth migration happened again in the later Mughals' time. And this was in 1720 under Mullah Abdul Nabi. He was also called Mohar Khan. And again, he started a campaign of persecution of kafirs or infidels, as they were known. And this is the time that even more diktats had come again. The diktats at this time were, no Hindu shall ride a horse, or no Hindu shall wear, I find this very interesting, no Hindu shall wear a shoe. That was very interesting. They should not wear any of the Mughal costumes. They should not move around with bare arms. They should not put a tilak on their foreheads. When we talk about genocide in later terms, understand these threads. They should not wear a tilak on their foreheads. Their children should not receive any education. And it goes on. It was to this day that Hindus were tormented, houses burnt again, property looted, and this was the fifth exodus that happened. By now, we are almost on about 20% of the population. Sixth, and the most cruel, I keep saying most cruel, but it really keeps getting more and more heinous. And this was during the Afghan rule in Kashmir, 1753 to 1819. W.R. Lawrence, the historian, and I quote him, he says, the barbarous Afghans employed every wild, inhuman, primitive, ferocious, cruel, and brutal method to suppress the Hindus. This is the time when Hindus were tied in grass sacks by two and drowned in Dal Lake. Those of you know what Dal Lake is. This is the time when you have that Batamazar, the graveyard of Hindus that now exists, that still exists in Kashmir. If any of you notice it, I lived in Kashmir all my life and I never went to Batamazar. My parents never took me there. I had heard of it. And this is something that we probably have to learn to be able to talk about our past with our children and to the future generation. Because when I was there, my parents never told me or even took me to Batamazar, which all of us should have done. But this, it exists there. I know it exists. It is in the records. It exists. So any of you can see that. And then we come to the, by this time now, after the Afghan rule, the population has already shrunk to about 6-7%. And we come all the way to 1989-90. Now, did this, and this is a list of Kashmiri Hindus that we talk about, did it start? A lot of people ask me, is there a date that when this current crisis started? And people give dates, they, November of 1989, when Rubaiya Sayyid, daughter of then Home Minister of India, Mufti Mohammad Said, was kidnapped. People say, is that when it started or when did it start? And now from this point onwards, what I am telling you, I am not relying on secondary source that I have read. Now I am the primary source because I have seen it with my own eyes. So I tell people that in early 80s, even though we were not living, there was no state of siege, it hadn't started, But we were already living in a hostile majority. All of us knew that. We knew that we were living in a hostile majority. A sense of siege came later in about 86. But before that, we already knew about our place. So I knew that if I'm going with my father to the temple, and I knew that my father would, you know, something that had probably started in 1300s, he would wipe off his dinner from the temple the minute he would go to work or anything would come out of the temple. And I had started doing that. Many years later in Delhi, my friends asked me, I had developed this habit. So whenever I would go to the temple, the minute I would come out, I would take off the thing. This is, you know, transgenerational trauma that people talk about. And I didn't know I was doing it. So my friends would ask me, and I realized that this is something that nobody has told me, but it has passed on for probably 10 generations now, that we have gotten into this habit of hiding our identity. So this was going on at that point. So this hostile majority. So if a cousin was playing with a game of cricket with a neighbor's son, his mom would tell him that if a Hindu child was playing, he was told that, you know, come home early. If you get into a fight, don't get into a fight. You know, just give up. Just come back home. Don't get into any kinds of fights. Don't speak loudly. Don't, you know, those kind of things. I mean, it's very difficult for most of you to understand how it is to live in an Islamic majority rule, because most of you haven't lived. Those of us who have, we can explain to you what it is. It is stifling, because you're always worried for your life. So all this slight things were happening. My mother was, I remember, she was a teacher in what is there, downtown Srinagar. She had already started telling, she would come home, and downtown Srinagar was mostly, you know, where, which was a lot of Muslims lived there in some ghettos. So she would come home and she would tell me that something is going on. This is around 85, 86. She would say something is going around. We don't know what is. Guns had not come up. But by this time, young boys had started started disappearing. So one day a milk person would come to our door and say, my son has gone for train. And then another day a newspaper wala's son would come and say that my newspaper wala would come and say my son has gone for train. And my mother, I remember in her naivety, she used to come and tell me that so and so's son, I'm so happy for them, they have gone for an engineering training, because for her training only meant engineering. You only got trained to become an engineer. She didn't understand anything else. So she used to be very happy. So she used to say that, you know, I'm so happy for so and so, they're going for training, not realizing that all it was happening across the valley. Young boys were disappearing. Where were they going? They were going across the border to POK, Pakistan occupied Kashmir, where there were camps. And they were getting trained there in using Kalashnikovs and AK-47s and all that. And they would then come and start a war against in the state of India. We did not know this at that time. We were still living in some, even though we have, as remember what I told you in the beginning, that even though we had this civilizational memory, but most of us had chosen to forget it. And most of us will choose to forget it after I speak to you, after we go home today also, because that is how it is, sort of, that's how we're raised. But if anybody had remembered these threads from 1339, they would have known that something is developing. There is a storm that is brewing. We didn't know. And then the selected killing started. The first killing was, you must have heard most of you, Nitika Lal W. He was the tallest Kashmiri leader. He belonged to J&K wing of Bharatiya Janata Party, that is the ruling party right now. He was a member of political worker. He was an office bearer. And he was shot at point blank range outside his home for Nitika Lal W. At this time now, everybody knew something was happening. Then Justice Neelkant Ganju, another justice, another judge, he was shot dead. In fact, I just met his granddaughter the other day. So now these selected killings were started. But people like us and my family, we were still in a fool's paradise because we thought that, you know, this is, we had always been told, Kashmiri Pandits had always been told that, you know, we had always been othered. We had always been told that we are the instruments of Indian state. So we felt that these were prominent people who were going to get killed, but we would be safe. This is, I'm telling you, late 1989. We felt we were going to ordinary people like us. What do we care? I mean, yes, prominent people like judges and politicians and all these. And there is something going on, something brewing, but we didn't understand that there was a major ethnic cleansing going on. At this time, we had not understood this. We felt that something is, all that changed on night of 19th January 1990. That was the day, and I remember, I had gone to my grandparents, and this is the story I have told numerous times, and if anyone you've heard it, I apologize, but for the benefit of those who have not heard, January 19, 1990, I had gone to my grandfather's house, it was his birthday, and my mother and I, there was curfew in the city already, because I remember I told you targeted killings had started. There was curfew in the city, there was CRPF everywhere. And we walked, my grandfather's house was about 15 minutes walk. So my mother and I walked, and we were planning to come back, but my grandfather said, no, you stay here. You can always go back tomorrow. There will be some, you know, they will, they used to give some time during the curfew, an hour or so to buy groceries. They said, that's how you came today. Tomorrow also there will be some time that they will give and you can go back home. So my mother and I stayed. That night I remember, and I'll briefly tell you because I have to cover a lot. We were sitting in our homes and about 10 o'clock at that night, my mother went out in the, if you know the old houses in India, and especially in Sri Lanka, you used to, in order to use a restroom, you would have to walk through the courtyard and then go to the restroom. So my mother walked out at 10 o'clock. We were all watching a movie, my grandfather, my grandmother, me, and my cousin, 17-year-old cousin. We were sitting there. She walks out and she screams. We thought she had fallen. We went down and we hear blaring noises from, at that time we didn't know, we thought we had been get out, we didn't know they were coming from the mosques, but they were all coming from the mosques, blaring noises. I still remember women on the microphones, men on the microphones, and they were doing slogans. This is the first time we heard the slogan, few slogans we had, Hum Kya Chahte Azadi had already happened, that had already happened. And another, relive, galiv, chaliv, which means flee or convert or die. This also had come in small, even though it had not become widespread, but it had been already heard. But that day, we heard some new slogans that had never been heard before, and on loudspeakers. And I'm standing in that courtyard, not knowing that in entire Srinagar, remember this is the time before WhatsApps and social media and everything. So this was a well coordinated thing. Think what it would take to coordinate a conspiracy or a thing, event of this kind in 1989, in 1990, where every mosque at one point in Kashmir in the middle of winter is blaring these slogans, and the slogans we heard were Kashmir mein rehna hai to Allahu Akbar kehna hai. Anyone wanting to live in Kashmir will have to convert to Islam. Zalimo kafiro, Kashmir hamara chhod do. Kafirs or infidels, leave our Kashmir. La sharqiya la garbiya islamiya islamiya. From east to west, there will only be Islam. These are the slogans we were hearing. Islam hamara maqsad hai. Jihad hamara raasta hai. Islam is our objective. Jihad is our way of life. Kashmir banega Pakistan, which we heard. Then Another slogan which I still remember and I get PTSD when I hear it, Dil mein rakho Allah ka khauf, haath mein rakho Kalashnikov. With fear of Allah ruling your hearts, wield a Kalashnikov. Yahan kya chalega, Nizam-e-Mustafa? It is very painful to go over these slogans, but I made it a point to read all of them here, because when you know all these slogans, these are not just, they don't come out of thin air. When anybody tells you that the Kashmir war is a war of self-determination, it is a war where people wanted self-determination is a right for every human being, right? In modern times, everyone gets to decide where they want to live in self-determination. But if this was a war of self-determination, why were these slogans coming from mosques? Why were minorities, those are aboriginals of Kashmir, targeted? If this was a war of self-determination, why was a slogan that put a dagger through the hearts of my family and everybody at that time, ऐसे-ऐसे कश्मीर, बटा रोस्ते बटन इंसान, we want Kashmir with the women folk, Kashmiri Pandit women folk, but without their men. That is a slogan that went like a dagger through the hearts. And that is when this small, tiny minority, that was just 5% or 6% at that time, they started to pack their bags and leave, and thus started our seventh exodus, which still continues. What happened after the exodus? And after that, it didn't end on that day. It wasn't like those mosques and things happened. After that, the selected killings continued. My family lived there till August of 1990. Most Hindus, about what was left, about this 5-6%, almost 99% of them had left. But my family stayed there till August 1990. We lived through B.K. Ganju's killing. B.K. Ganju, a young engineer, was shot dead in a rice drum. And his wife was forced to eat the blood-soaked rice of her husband. We lived through Girija Tikku's rape and murder. Girija Tikku was a young lab assistant who was kidnapped and raped by people she knew. All of this was done by people being me. It was betrayal in the backyard. Girija Tikku was kidnapped, raped, gang raped, and then she was not shot dead easily. She was cut, she was put on a manual saw and cut into two halves. Please tell me, how is this different from what Sikandar Bhutshikar did? Please tell me, how is this different from what Iraqi did? Please tell me, how is this different from what Afghan rulers did? So, do you see a thread from 1339 to 2022? Because there is a thread in the cruelty, in the persecution, there is a solid thread that comes right from the point to this point. One of my relatives, who was a sort of self-styled leader of Kashmiri Pandits, his name was Mr. Agent Jattu. After these selected killings, he wrote to JKLF, Jammu Kashmir Liberation Front, which was the front at that time. After that, there have been so many organizations. There has been Hizbul Mujahideen and Lashkar-e-Toyba and Jaish-e-Mohammed. Doesn't matter, it's global network of jihadis. It doesn't matter, the names keep changing, but the modus operandi is the same, and what they want to do is the same, which is the war against State of India and Islamized Kashmir. That was the only what they wanted to do. So Mr. Jadu, he wrote to JKLF and he told them that now you have started this, and this is an answer, a slap to those people who say that this is a war of self-determination. What do you want this tiny majority, tiny minority of Kashmiri Pandits to do? Next day, his assistant Ashok Ghazi was shot dead. So we clearly knew what was going on. And there are so many names that I can give you. There's Naveen Sapru, there's Ashok Ghazi, there are names that rattle through my mind. There's Babri Rana, there is so many names that if I continue to tell you, we will be here for 2 days. But my endeavor today is to A, tell you that there is a link between all this that has been happening for 700 years, and to establish that what happened to Kashmiri Pandits is a genocide the way the modern genocide scholars define genocide. This is a classic form of genocide which should be recognized, and all of you young students, you should actually be talking about it, and hopefully, you know, we will get some hearing from the United Nations, because genocide is a crime, is an international crime, is a crime against United Nations. So anytime a genocide happens in any country, it is the duty of the group of countries, the international community, to make sure that people are punished for their crimes, the genocidal crimes. So I hope you will, once I'm done with this presentation, you will see how this follows a typical story, typical case of genocide. Torture deaths that have been happening for last 700 years, and I have noticed them, they all have been similar in a way. How have they been? By hanging, by burning alive, strangulation by steel wires. It's funny that in 700 years, these methods did not change. Draining of blood in hospitals, drowning alive, beating to death, dragging to death, breaking of body parts, dismemberment of body, slicing, gouging of eyeballs, branding with red hot iron ball, slaughter. This hasn't changed. The methods have not changed. When we talk about genocide, the UN Convention on the Prevention and Punishment and the Crime of Genocide, if you look at this thing, they recognize, they tell you that in the present convention, genocide means any of the following acts committed with the intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnical, racial or religious group. And what are the forms that they give? This is UN, this is in 1948. Killing members of a group, causing seriously bodily or mental harm to members of the group, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part, imposing measures intended to prevent births within the group, forcibly transferring children of the group to another group. These are 5 things that they say that, and UN says, the law says, the UN Convention says, if the crime, if even one of these crimes is satisfied, even one of these crimes is satisfied, it is a genocide. Kashmiri Pandits satisfy 4 out of the 5 of these. So clearly it is a genocide. Other than forcibly transferring children of a group to another group, all 4. The persecution of Kashmiri Pandits, this satisfies that. And what does the UN Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of Crime and Genocide say? What act should be punishable? Genocide. Conspiracy to commit genocide is also a crime. Direct and public incitement to commit genocide is also a crime. Attempt to commit genocide and complicity in genocide. On this also, the criminals, the war criminals, the genocidal criminals that are still alive and are in Kashmir right now, therefore they should be all these acts are punishable. Remember what has happened to Kashmiri Pandits in the modern times, in from 1989, not one person has been punished. Not one person has been punished for any of these crimes. Some of you might have watched the film, The Kashmir Files, and you may have seen, heard the names Bitta Karate and Yasin Malik and all this. But these are not the only names. There are thousands of other people, and these just are celebrity terrorists. But Bitta Karate and Yasin Malik, Yasin Malik is on record, he has said on television record, on television interview, that he has killed Kashmiri Pandits. He has also killed four IAF officers. He's also involved in kidnappings and raids. But guess what? He's in the jail right now. Guess what? He's under trial. The trial hasn't even started, obviously. So what is he in jail for? He is in jail for terror funding and kidnapping. Later, after much hue and cry, the case of IAF officers, Indian Air Force officers, four Indian Air officers that he killed, that case was added. The still, killing of Kashmiri Pandits has not been added to his roster of crimes. So where will the trial start? So there is not one, same thing for Bitta Karate, his Farooq Ahmedar is his name, and goes by the name Bitta Karate. He is on record that he has killed 23 Kashmiri Hindus. Is in jail again, I believe, for terror funding, because the state has not been able to prove that these people were killed. They have not been able to prove in the court of law. When Kashmiri Pandits went to the Supreme Court of India, they were told it's too old, it's 32-year-old story. Where are we going to get cases now? Where are we going to find proofs now? And some of us told them that we are alive to tell the story. Our parents and grandparents are alive. Some of us are alive who have seen, the eyewitnesses are alive. But they said it's too late. Perhaps they are actually waiting for it to be so late that when all these eyewitnesses die, because once the eyewitnesses die, then it becomes a folklore, and then it becomes a story like Shikandar Butshikan and Iraqi, and then the modern historians will tell you, well, it never happened. Where is the proof? It is a folklore, because that's what they tell you for the last 700 years. Every time the generation, the three generations finish off and there are no eyewitnesses left, then it becomes a folklore. You didn't see, I didn't see. We don't know. It's not been proven in the court of case. That is what has been happening. Again, a thread, right from 1339 to 2022. You do not want to prove, you do not want to show in the court of law that these crimes have been committed even in modern times. Gregory Stanton is a famous genocide scholar, and he has given 10 stages of genocide, and he has said that any of these stages, if you read them, any kind of crime should be weighed against this. And this is how genocide approaches. This is how genocide happens. Classification. People are divided into us and them. Again, I told you how this happened with Kashmiri Pandits, my entire presentation, how we were told that we were othered. The tallest leader of Jammu and Kashmir, Farooq Abdullah's father, Sheikh Abdullah, he, in his autobiography, Atishe Chinar, had already called Kashmiri Hindus fifth colonists, which meant that they were agents of the enemy state. So we were already called agents of the enemy state. So this is the othering. Everywhere, we were killed as, the word used is Mukbir. Mukbir means that you are spies of Indian state. Most Kashmiri Hindus were killed because they were called spies of Kashmiri, of Indian state. So that is classification. Symbolization, people are forced to identify themselves. So we were forced, there were ways that we were identified. And this is again gone from the time for last 700 years. Discrimination, people begin to face systematic discrimination. Even in my time, there has been discrimination always, but even in my time, simple things like getting a spot in medical schools or engineering schools, even in that time, it was very difficult for a Kashmiri Pandit boy or girl to get it. And they would, in fact, that was also one of the soft exoduses that was happening around my time, because a lot of young boys and girls were moving out to study. So it was impossible to get a spot because all those were reserved. And obviously they were not said. Dehumanization. People are equated with animals, vermin, or diseases. So there were a lot of racial slurs that were passed. We have grown up with this, and now it doesn't even sometimes register. But the things that were told us, we were called dalibatas, people who eat dal. So therefore, dal was always something that is the cowards eat. So therefore, we were allowed. So dalibatal, dalidal, all these racial slurs were passed. Which is this, again, Gregory Stanton says that anytime there is dehumanization, it is a step of genocide. Then organization that was happening, when I told you people were going and getting trained in jihad from across the border, that is organization, where they were getting all equipped with modern automatic guns. And that night on 19th January, my 70-year-old grandfather was in my house, and when he heard the noise, he went inside. He tied my mother and I because he was worried for us, and he knew what has happened to Hindu women in the past. He went to the 70-year-old man who has never harmed a fly. He went to the kitchen and he got two kitchen knives. And then he went to the attic and he got a rusted axe. And those were his weapons. And those weapons were not to kill anybody. Those weapons were to kill us. In case somebody came in, the weapons were to kill his daughter and his granddaughter. Because if we landed in the hands of jihadis, that would have been a much worse fate than being killed by your own father and grandfather. So you can imagine. That is organization. Polarization, where government broadcasts propaganda to turn the populace against the group. This was happening completely in the newspapers, Al-Safa newspaper and Aftab newspaper and all these local newspapers that were in the state. This was happening. They were printing propaganda of the terrorists. So that is polarization. Preparation, where official action to relocate people begins, where they sort of, in 1986, a dress rehearsal was done for what was to come in 1990, except we didn't know, in a place called Anantnag. Now it's called Anantnag riots. It should not be called Anantnag riots, because riots happen when two people clash. It was not a clash, it was a pogrom. It was one group. For flimsiest of reasons, the houses and the stores and temples in Anantnag were destroyed, and that was just, people called it riot. Even now if you Google, people will call it riot. It was not a riot, it was a pogrom, and it was preparation for what was to come in 1990. So that's preparation. Then persecution, beginning of murders, theft of property, trial massacres, and then as I told you how persecution happened with targeted murders, and then of course you have massacres that have happened. Nadi Marg massacre, when 23 Kashmiri Hindus were killed, and then Sangrampura massacre, there are other Vandhama massacre where people were together lined up and they were killed. Then extermination, whether it's wholesale elimination of the group, and this is when accidents happen. This is when the real ethnic cleansing. When you are exterminated, when you are given the choice, three choices, flee, convert, or die, that is extermination, which is what we faced. And then denial, which is the stage that we are at now. There is a denial of genocide, and as long as there is a denial of genocide, the genocide will not end. The genocide only ends when it is accepted, when people realize that a genocide has happened, and then they do active, people who have committed genocidal crimes are punished, and that is when we move towards truth and reconciliation. Unless that happens, there is no truth. Unless truth happens, there can be no reconciliation. So this is the denial stage where we are, when Kashmiri Hindus are. I would request, I don't have that much time, and I know there is a question answer session also, and I would like to answer all questions as well. So I'll end my presentation here. My goal here was to tell you that please do not look at the events of 1990 in isolation. If you want to understand the history of Kashmiri Pandits, if you want to even solve this problem, because after all, what do we want? We also want peace. We also want to solve this issue. But then we will have to understand the history. We will have to go back to 700 years, and we will have to understand where we come from. Thank you very much.
Questions that we collected from all of you. Thank you very much for sending them in. You might just sign in.
Yeah, please.
I think one question which a lot of people had, and that I personally had as well, was you talked about how this is a continuous genocide. This is not
continual
genocide.
Yes.
Sorry, and this has not ended.
Yes.
So given the recent events that have occurred with the abrogation of Article 370, the bifurcation of Jammu and Kashmir, how do you think that will affect Kashmiri Pandits and our future?
That's, I'm glad you asked me that question, because in the present, this that makes a lot of thing. Article 370, those of you, I don't know how much you know, and could actually spend more time talking about it, but in brief, just to tell you, it was, India had rejected two nation theory. Most of you know why Pakistan was made. It was when they had, the two-nation theory was that Hindus and Muslims cannot coexist, and therefore Muslims need a separate state of their own, and that's why Pakistan was formed. India rejected two-nation theory and said, we do not accept that Hindus and Muslims cannot coexist. And that is why India has a secular constitution, and that is why India does not, the constitution of India does not discriminate against anybody. And that is why Pakistan became, because Pakistan accepted two-nation theory, it officially became Islamic Republic of Pakistan. But what did India do in Kashmir was going totally against what they had said. They had said they rejected two-nation theory, but in India, in Kashmir, they introduced Article 370, which was a special status to the state. And why was the state given special status? Because it was the only Muslim majority in the country. So in a way, they were saying that any Muslim majority country, state, cannot exist like that in the secular Indian government. It needs special safeguards. When it says it needs special safeguards, it was accepting the two-nation theory. So it went against what India at that time stood for. It was supposed to be a temporary period article. It just continued for 70 years. What that 370 did was it othered us even more. That we were talking, Hindus and even any resident of Kashmir, they never became full citizens of India, because now they were governed by two set of rules. So imagine Texas having its own set of laws. So suppose United States, I have actually written a piece about it in Houston Chronicle, and I'll be happy to send it to you and you can circulate it. Imagine you're living in Texas and federal government gives a tax break, for example, but now it's not applicable to you, even though it's applicable to every other state because you live in Texas, right? So it was things like that. What I'm giving you is a very superficial example, but that's what Article 370 did. A lot of progressive laws of Indian Constitution were not applicable in Kashmir. And what it was doing emotionally and psychologically, it was othering people, and it was affecting Hindus the most. Because now, because of that, we were not able to become full citizens and enjoy the fruits of secular constitution. Now that Article 370 has gone, what it has done is it has psychologically removed the fear. So A, it was very important because Kashmir is also, you can view the Kashmir situation from a terrorism point of view also, and from a security point of view also. So it was very important that from that view, Article 370 is removed. But from the psychological point of view, I think the fear has somehow gone. And it is because of that fear going that movies like Kashmir Files and all this are coming about now. Because there is, somehow people feel that we can speak. So I think that psychologically it has done a lot of good. But do we need to do more? Yes. Because of the abrogation of Article 370 and removal of 35A, now the domicile law has been introduced. A lot of people who had moved even before 1989 and 1947, from 1947 onwards, they can claim domicile. So with that, we have increased the base of people, we're trying the demographics in a way. But it's at a very early stages right now. And I think this was the first step. After this, a lot needs to be done. In terms of security, and B, for Kashmiri pundits to come back. Abrogation of Article 370 is not the only thing. We will also need to feel secure, and the only way we'll feel secure is if some of the people who perpetrated these crimes against us are punished. Unless that happens, I don't think anybody will feel comfortable going back. But it's a good first step.
And just going off of what you talked about with Article 370, I think one thing that we did see a lot, unfortunately, in Western media, and perhaps maybe in some Indian media outlets as well, was this way of phrasing this as somehow being taking away democracy from people, getting rid of self-determination, and not actually covering the perspective that a lot of Kashmiri Hindus have on this. Why do you think, in your opinion, a lot of Western media outlets fail to identify the situation and push the truth under the carpet? Do you think it's ideological, financial, perhaps a combination of both?
It is a combination of ignorance and arrogance, because they refuse to read. And because I'm from media and I know how journalism works. But to answer, Article 370, abrogation of Article 370 is a restoration of human rights. It is not taking away human rights. As I just explained, that Indian Constitution that is modeled on American US Constitution is the most progressive and liberal piece of document. It is like United Nations, a very liberal document. All of it was not applicable in Kashmir. So this liberal document of Kashmir is not applicable to Kashmir, and yet our friends in global media, in New York Times and Washington Post, they tell you that it is removal of human rights, or it is a curtailing of human rights. I just don't understand how that works. A lot of it also is, so one has to understand, one has to go deeper and say that why are they doing this? They're not fools. So a whole, there is a problem in India and in global media about Hindus. Hindus are never looked as victims in India. So a lot of people, and I've spoken to a lot of these people, they don't understand a basic thing that Hindus were a minority in Kashmir. Even this basic thing escapes them somehow. That's why I said it's a combination of ignorance and arrogance. A, they're ignorant, and B, they're arrogant. So they will not listen. So they fail to understand that we are a minority in this thing. So you tell them all about our travails and they say, but you're a majority, you are 80% in India, how is that? So they don't understand all that. Besides, the liberal media in United States and most of the Western world has joined hands, unfortunately, and it's a pity, but they have joined hands with Global Jihad Network for some reason. And when they join hands with Global Jihad Network, they're not going to talk about Hindu victims. And they have started doing this whole thing about Islamophobia. They have gotten into these non-existent issues. And when they are talking about, when they are going to talk about Islamophobia, when they're going to talk about things which may or may not exist, but then they refuse to look at the victims of Islamist jihad. When they refuse to look at the victims of Islamist jihad, obviously they're not going to talk about, they're not going to look at Kashmiri Pandits, and they're not going to look at Hindus in general, and they're not going to be talking about things. I think it's a lost cause. I have come to the point where I don't even worry about it. Internet is a huge medium which has democratized our voice. We should use it. We should talk about it. Hindu YUVA is doing a phenomenal job. We should learn to bypass global media, global liberal media, which is what my advice to young people would be. Learn to bypass it. Learn to make your voice stronger and more powerful. If there is truth in your voice, you will be heard. You do not have to be a columnist of New York Times to be heard anymore. You can have a very good Substack column and a Substack subscription. I promise I will pay for it. And there will be other people, and you can have your voice heard. It's a lost cause, Suraj. It's not going to happen. Unless something globally changes, the politics of the United States changes, it's not going to work.
I think that's great, and I think that's very important that, you know, we speak out, you know, even when certain media outlets may not cover our voices. It's great to speak out. And just going off of that, we have another great question about recently President Biden recognized the Armenian genocide.
Yes.
Which that was unfortunately also ignored,
yes,
for many
100
years.
Yes.
Have there been any attempts, and what are some ways that you think Hindu YUVA and others, Hindus in general, at UT and just across the country, can make efforts to get this genocide recognized at a higher level, at a governmental level, perhaps?
Yeah. The first thing that we can do is awareness. Events like this that you are doing, this is wonderful. For longest time, we were afraid to use the word, which is including me, we were afraid to use the word genocide, even though I was a victim myself. I was afraid to use the word genocide because I had really not studied genocide clearly. It's only when I studied it and I studied my own history that I understood that those stages of genocide we have actually gone through. So creating of awareness. B, I have been fighting, and this has been my personal journey for a long time, and a lot of people have now come, have joined hands with me. I have been asking Indian government that please start, a lot of people are now in their, my grandmother's generation is already gone. My parents' generation are getting old and they're forgetting. It is very important. What happens to me needs to happen now is that we need to record depositions. And not like this. Proper depositions have to happen in a court setting, in a formal court setting, not blogs, not this, where all this is documented. First of all, we have to document everything. So I would really, really hope that young people like you prevail on governments across the world, including Indian government, that please have these formal depositions. I was fortunate to get my voice in US Congress and make the first deposition of its kind ever in United States Congress. So that is in record now, but I was given 7 minutes, and there is only so much one can speak in 7 minutes. But those kind of depositions need to happen in Indian Parliament. Indian Parliament needs to listen. And after that, there can be a court of inquiry. And after that, we can sit and talk about genocidal crimes and punishment. But so this has been my journey. But other than that, I think what people can do is, with these depositions, with what I have been telling you today, with the kind of presentations I have been making, please go to your representatives, talk to them, do presentations like this, and tell them that why Kashmiri Pandit's genocide deserves to be recognized as a genocide, not just for Kashmiri Pandits and not just for us, but so for the people of the world, so that people learn a lesson, and such persecution of anybody is avoided anywhere in the world. No person, no human being, no one human being should persecute another human being. And if we have to do that, then genocides like these would need to be recognized. So I would request you to speak to your representatives. You are all now, you know, adults. So speak to your representatives, talk to them, and tell them that why this deserves to be recognized as a genocide.
Also, another question that we had was, you know, you talked about the importance of having these depositions, putting them all in a centralized location so we have, you know, a certain place that we can all look to for information. I got a question relating to that. I think there's a lot of people who were not exactly familiar with this, not exactly familiar with the details. A lot of what you just shared with them was the first time they'd ever heard that. Despite the fact that I am Kashmiri Pandit, there were some things that you said that I didn't even know about. So I certainly learned a lot from hearing you speak. Do you know if there are any websites, online resources, anything like that where, you know, we can all go to look up more about this genocide?
First thing all of you should do today is, when you go home, order my friend Rahul Pandita's book, Our Moon Has Blood Clots. That is the most authentic memoir of Kashmiri Pandit persecution. It's written by Rahul, he's a very well-known journalist, and he has very accuracy, this is forte. So he has very accurately portrayed this entire thing, because he was, he's a victim himself, he lives in Delhi right now. So pick up that book. Another book, I would say, another great resource, once you have read this, is Jagmohan's My Frozen Turbulence. Anybody who wants to understand the present situation in Kashmir cannot do this without reading Jagmohan, who was a governor of Kashmir twice, in 1984 to 89, and then for 4 months in 1990. So you cannot even begin to understand without reading his book, because he really understood the Kashmir situation really well. Then there's a lot of work that has been going on. I have written a lot, and I have done a lot of YouTube videos. So if any of you go up and look up what I have spoken today, is just one fraction, not even fraction, it's just the tip of the iceberg. But there are lots of YouTube videos of mine that you can see in my articles, that you can in my writing, that is up there, that can be looked up. Then there is Project RRR. Remember, Revere, and React. This has been done by young volunteers who have chronicled the names of every single victim. In fact, you can help these volunteers because even now we are realizing, because there's no government agency, till now government of India has not put together any white paper or any, there's no resource, government resource that you can see. They have not expressed interest till now. So there are private organizations that are doing this. So this group of volunteers, Project R3, and if anybody's interested, I can give Suraj the information and he can pass it on. They are actually looking for all volunteers who know any information, and they're putting it together. So this is one way any of you can get involved. If you know of any Kashmiri Pandit family who has gone through this, please have them sort of quote unquote register on this website and tell their story, because this is one centralized place where we are trying to put all depositions together. We can't wait for the government to do it. Till then, at least we are doing this. So these are some of the websites that you can, some of the books and these things that you can look at. And there are two movies now that have come out. There is Shikara and there is the Kashmir Files. Those two movies can be looked, and that's where you start.
We'll definitely make sure to keep track of all these books and, you know, keep writing them down and collect them all summer, so that anybody that has more questions can look into all that. On a slightly different note, you know, you talked about how you heard the mosques blasting all this hateful propaganda against Hindus, and unfortunately, a lot of this hate came from people that you said you knew, local neighbors, friends, coworkers. What do you think, you know, are some ways that perhaps Kashmiri Hindus and Kashmiri Muslims can, you know, reunite in some ways, and, you know, we can reconcile and become one? And what are some ways to sort of stamp out this extremist mentality that some Kashmiri Muslims unfortunately develop towards us?
First would be recognition of what has happened to us. Even now, Suraj, when you go to Kashmir, you will be told that Kashmiri Pandits fled because Jagmohan made them flee. Even now, there is zero consensus, even after all this, on why we left. They will not accept it. They will not accept that such brutalities were committed. A lot of these people will not accept that these slogans were said. Unless truth is accepted and confronted, victims cannot be expected to reconcile. Reconciliation is a very noble deed, and I support it, and it should happen, because after all, how can a society survive? You know, you can't keep fighting. You can't be in a complete zone of flux all the time. But for that, truth has to be accepted. First of all, you have to accept why, what happened. Once that is accepted, I think we can move forward. A Truth and Reconciliation Commission should be and must be set. But for that, even now, I have been, after this movie was released, I was doing after the movie, I was doing this television night circuit for about a week, prime time circuit on Indian TV. And every time, and you know how Indian news TV works, every time I was pitted against somebody from the valley, they would tell me, well, but you know, only 217 people died. How do you know only 217 people died? They don't accept anything from Indian government. Any truth from Indian government, they don't accept. But this weird number that has come out from somewhere, 217, they keep throwing you at your face, only 217 people died. I can count 400 people, just me personally, I have put together 400 victims. So that's just one person. I know about 400 people died. There is nobody knows how many people died, how many people were made homeless, how many mosques were, how many temples were destroyed. We don't know all of this. So, but they'll keep telling you. So even now, I mean, this is just a week ago when I was butting my head on the television. So there's no acceptance of truth. I would really request them to accept truth, and only then can we make progress.
Thank you very much for that. I'd like to open up the floor to questions from any of you have questions.
I'm not clear on what the best case scenario is going forward. So it is still going to, like, let's say that it's recognized universally that this was a genocide.
Tell me your name first.
I'm Advait.
Advait.
Let's say it's universally recognized as a genocide. I'm not clear on why that helps exactly, other than like psychologically, I guess, the emotion. But like, it's still gonna be, Kashmiri Pandits will still be a minority. And then how do you, it'll just happen again 100 years from now.
Yeah, that's why I call it a continual genocide. No, that is why genocide needs to be recognized and people, perpetrators need to be punished. Because unless there is punishment, see, it is not that in India, riots have not happened before. It's not that people have not, unspeakable crimes have not happened against people in India. We know. But were they all genocidal crimes? No. So if, there are riots that have happened over India, communal riots are very common, or at least used to be very common when I was growing up in India. Now they have stopped, or now we don't see much of them. But none of those are genocidal crimes. And there are laws in Indian constitution where you can punish the riot perpetrators. But then what do you do about the people who perpetrated this genocide? There are no laws. There are no laws in the country right now because the genocide has not been accepted. So a law has not been formulated. There are no laws whereby you can punish them. Once perpetrators of the crime are punished, we're hoping that it becomes a deterrent for future. That is one. B, there is a section of Kashmiri Pandits now who have come up with what is called Marg Darshan Resolution of 1991, an organization called Palu Kashmir. They have said, they have exactly the same question. They have said, this is our seventh exodus. In 100 years, it's going to happen again because every third generation has seen it. So what are we going to do? They have been asking for a separate group, separate land, a homeland to be carved out in Jammu and Kashmir for Kashmiri Pandits, where demographically they will be in strength and where there will be, it will be a union territory, which is a federally controlled territory, and where people from rest of the India can happily, because still Article 370 was there, Indians from rest of the country could not settle, live in Kashmir, so the demographics could not be changed. So they have been saying, Palu Kashmir is an organization that has been asking for a homeland. They have done a lot of work on this. You can go on Palu Kashmir website. They have said, and I think for a long time, I was sort of ambivalent to the idea, but now the same question comes to my mind too, that how are we going to prevent it? And they are saying, their idea is that this is the only way to prevent it. Don't create settlements, don't create these ghettos in Kashmir. That's not going to help. Carve out a separate homeland for them where we can change the demographics will help. Because after all, if anything you have learned today, it should be that demography is destiny.
I actually just have a personal question just for you. When I discuss this issue, I think this is true for a lot of people, when they discuss this issue with people who have a different viewpoint on this, a common response that we're met with is, well, the Indian government has done some bad things to Kashmiri Muslims, so it's the same there, it's just whatever, it's hearsay. And so how would you respond to that allegation and help people realize that this is a genocide, and regardless of what may have happened to you from whatever government, it doesn't justify this.
Correct. So a lot of questions do get asked about the excesses of so-called alleged excesses of Indian army in Kashmir. And the answer, another thing that is often said is that but Kashmiri Muslims also died, and they died in large numbers. So obviously, because if you look at the population, then proportionately, many Kashmiri Muslims also died. Why did they die? Kashmiri Muslims died. There are two kinds of things that happened to them. A, they were killed by terrorists, people they sheltered, and people whose ideology they may or may not have agreed to, but they kept silent for the longest time. And so they were killed at the hands of terrorists, and against whom they will still not speak. If a terrorist kills any Kashmiri Muslim, you will still not see any hue and cry in global media about that. Other Muslims who were killed were patriotic Muslims who died, and I'm not denying the existence of patriotic Muslims, they died for the idea of India, for supporting Indian cause. That is why they died. That is why they were killed. But was that a genocide? Does that follow any of the 10 steps of genocide? No. So these two cannot be compared. Of course, there have been crimes against them too. But another thing you have to ask is, when terrorism comes anywhere, terrorism is the ultimate opponent of human rights. I firmly believe this. Anywhere where there is terrorism, you cannot talk about human rights until you eliminate terrorism first. You cannot talk about human rights without addressing the question of terrorism. So any Kashmiri Muslims who talk about this, they need to address the question of terrorism, because terrorism and human rights cannot exist. When Indian state has to defend itself, then some kind of human rights excesses will happen, because it happens everywhere else. When I came to this country in pre-9/11, I lived in Colorado, and I still remember that there was no Department of Homeland Security, by the way, you were able to go right till the aircraft to, if somebody came and saw you, and you were dropping somebody at the airport, instead of now how they stop you at the thing, you cannot go in, you were able to go and drop them right to the aircraft, right till the place. I mean, the older people, I think I'm the only one of that generation here who remembers that. This is not that old. But this is what has happened. Then 9/11 happened. Then what happens? Now they make you take off your shoes, they make you take off your thing. Do you question it? No. Why do you not question it? Because 9/11 happened. 2,000 people died, and after that died, it changed America. And then after that, you could not go there. So when terrorism happens, is that not killing your human rights? When I am told to go, and I'm told to take off my shoes, and full body scan is done and all that, is that not curtailing my human rights? I would like to go, my freedom of travel and freedom of existence, but I don't question it, because it's state's job to keep me safe, and it is state's job to defend itself. So when state is defending itself against terrorism, then we cannot talk about human rights till then. So anybody who wants to talk about human rights in Kashmir, as I want to talk about human rights, eliminate terrorism first, because both cannot coexist.
Do we have any other questions in the audience?
I have a question.
Yes.
First, thank you so much, Sunanda. Really, really appreciate your presentation.
Thank you.
I've grown up in Kashmir, lived through this there. But what I realized sort of consciously after watching Kashmir Files was three things. One was the sort of complicity of the government. When we say that the Kashmir story, the story of the Kashmiri Hindus was not known widely until, you know, for 30 years. Our friends who watched the movie go, we didn't know this happened. I just feel like there were three things that happened. One was the complicity of the government at that time, who for reasons of politics and, you know, vote bank politics, didn't think it prudent to talk about what was happening in Kashmir with Kashmiri Hindus. The second was the sort of maybe conscious or subconscious complicity of the media, who did not put the story out as broadly as it should have. And then the third, which it's difficult for me to say because I am a very liberal person, you know, from a social political standpoint, was the complicity of sort of the liberal the
ecosystem.
Liberal pseudo-intellectuals, let me just put it, whose understanding of the issue was about half an inch deep. How do you address that going forward? Because there's 30 years of water under the bridge. How do you get that to a point now where you can get past that? And you know, politics is politics. That's going to continue. So, you know, for whatever reasons, there'll be a different spin on the story for the next 30 years and things like that. How do you get past that? And to your point, put the truth out there.
Yeah.
Get the facts on record. How do you sort of keep doing that beyond what you've talked about?
There's a lot of momentum that has been created after the move in the Kashmir files, as you would agree. Suddenly there is, everyone's talking about it. I think this momentum should not be wasted. And this may or may not happen again. For the last 30 years we've been trying. I have been trying at least for 20 years that I have been actively involved through my work. And I have never seen this kind of, you know, gates open. And now there is acceptance. At least now in India, nobody can say with the success of the film that we did not. At least this much has happened. That at least now no one can say we did not. Oh, we didn't know. Now everyone knows. But where do we go from here? I think it is very important for us to prevail on the government that a white paper should be, made. A white paper should be formulated by the government. What that means is that there should be one official narrative of why we left Kashmir. Unless that, because even then there is no consensus. Just because I also agree here, there is no consensus in outside world actually. People don't accept it in that liberal ecosystem. They still say that, you went because suddenly you started feeling cold in Kashmir, or, Jagmohan had, the then governor had planned this conspiracy against you. They still say that. So we have to prevail upon the government that at least there should be one narrative about why we left. Once that is done, then there are a few things. I have been fighting against the Indian government still calls us migrants, like we are migratory birds. Migrants are people who move on their own accord. We were forced. So at least we should be recognized as internally displaced people, if not refugees, because that's an international connotation to that. So at least we should be recognized as internally displaced. These are low-lying fruits, you know? Addressing genocide in its totality is a larger thing. To get to that, we need to get to these little things. You know, get them to do depositions in camera, officially, under the aegis of Supreme Court. Get a retired judge there and get depositions of people who are still alive. Get a white paper out, present it in the parliament and say why we left. Change our nomenclature, don't call us migrants. And, most important, start trial on at least few people that you know, people who can testify against them, start trials. Those are the beginnings. If we can push. Right now, at least in Indian mainstream media, you can get your voice heard. That much has changed in the last 20 years now, and there's a lot of alternate media that has also come up, so we can get our words. I think every Hindu and every, I think this is a story of every Hindu, it's not just Kashmir. Remember, this is a civilizational battle. If there is no Kashmir, there is no India. Let me assure you of that, because Kashmir is the laboratory of jihad. If jihad is defeated in Kashmir, will we be able to defeat jihad everywhere else and India will be safe? So anyone who thinks that this is a story of Kashmiri Pandits and they need to fight, any Hindu who thinks that is mistaken. It is a job of every Hindu. Let's raise a voice. Let's talk about these four or five low-lying fruits at least. Once that is done, then maybe we can address the bigger issue of genocide being recognized. Which we think, I have hope, I live on hope. Otherwise, what is there to live for?
Just off of that, I think there's also a visit of the US representative last week to Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and there's also a very active Free Kashmir movement going on across the United States, both in academia, media, but also political circles. So do you also see that as a threat to existence of Kashmir in India as well?
Ms. Omar went to POK, and then State Department was quick to issue a rebuttal today and say that she has gone on her own accord, on her own time. It is not a state-sponsored visit. I don't know why Pakistani administration would meet her if she's not even on a state-sponsored visit. But Congresswoman Omar's allegiance is well known, and there is no question talking about that. Yes, there's a very strong lobby. When I was doing my deposition in US Congress, I was sitting, this was a table like this, where five of us, and it was a complete hostile crowd because everyone was speaking on one side and I was the only one who had an alternate voice and who was speaking in them. I was sitting there and I obviously could not look behind me, but when I was making my deposition in US Congress in Washington DC, there were people screaming behind me, "Hum kya chahte azadi." This happened in, the camera was not focused on them because I think the way the camera is set up, the microphone, it could only record my voice and the voice of the people who were hearing, but I could hear. And I wanted to make it, I knew that the camera is not catching it. So I wanted to register my dissent, and I told the chairman at that time, I said, if you do not bring the order to this house, I will not continue my deposition. And that is when the order was restored in the house. But this is in US Congress. US Congress people came in and were not afraid to scream Azadi slogans, the genocidal slogans that made us homeless. So yes, there is a very strong lobby. The media is with them, the global media is with them. They're not going to get even a sentence from our point of view. When the Kashmir Files was released, how many of you read the review that came out in the Time magazine? They refused to acknowledge even our story. Forget about the movie. They called it a lie. They called it an outright lie. And that is a magazine of the stature of Time. I mean, I have come to the point in my life where I sort of don't care anymore, and I do my own thing. But this is what Time magazine did. So the entire global media is with them, the entire thing is with them. It is an uphill fight. But that's why people like you exist, young people like you exist, so that we can pass on the baton to you now, and you can take our voice forward. It's for the younger people to do. We do our bit as much as we can. Let me tell you a very philosophical thing here, Ms. Rishi, because a lot of young people get, including my children, they get very worried. And then I tell them, what is time for a Hindu? Unlike other people, time is cyclical for us. Time doesn't start or end. For us, 1,000 years is nothing. Because we are here now, and 1,000 years later, another person will be there. We don't get scared of that. As long as we know that this battle may or may not be won in my lifetime, but I have given the baton to the one after me, that's all that we can do. And there will be a time where things will get better. And we may or may not be there to see it. That's all. That doesn't happen. That's no problem at all. Because for a Hindu, time is cyclical. We will come back and we'll see it.
I just have one final question.
Yes.
There's a scene in Kashmir Files, and for those of you that haven't seen the movie, I'll just briefly summarize it so you have some context. There's a young Kashmiri Pandit, young man in college. He's at a university, and he asks a professor, he says, I hear you're talking about Kashmir. You know, I was wondering why you didn't talk about the perspective of Kashmiri Hindus. And she responds to him with, well, what's your name? And he goes,
Krishna Pandit, and she goes, ah, your last name's Pandit, you're upper caste privilege, you can't talk about this. And I thought that was very interesting, that, you know, she took something so simple like that, and she took an issue of caste discrimination, which is a separate issue, and she weaponized that
yes.
to silence this boy. And so what do you think of the weaponization of this other issue, which is an issue that needs to be addressed, but the weaponization of it to silence Kashmiri Hindus and just people in general, do you think?
In my life, Suraj, I have learned that any time they want to get even with Hindus, or they want to say anything against Hindus, they cannot say it when they cannot say it loud, because they're still afraid of a few things. They immediately call it Brahminism. Brahmin is a euphemism for Hindu. Please understand that. It is not being, when they call out Brahminism, they're calling out Hinduism. So that is a way, it's a dog whistle. The minute they say that, they will say, oh, you upper caste people, and I haven't seen, I have grown up all my life in India. I wish I had seen some upper caste privilege. I didn't see any. And but that's a separate issue. We can talk about it all day long. But I do want you to understand that every time anybody says, pushes that this is a Brahmin issue or this is a Brahminical thing, he is talking, it's a dog whistle for Hinduism. Because they cannot say Hinduism, they still are still afraid, they still have some modus of this thing, especially in media and this thing, remember, because they still have some, they have to maintain some amount of integrity, or which is a facade, but this is their way of getting even with Hindus. So when she was saying that you have this Brahminical privilege and all, which is, this was their way of getting even with Hindus. Anytime they want to say anything to Hindus, they call it a Brahmin thing. So we should be very aware of it, and we should hit back as soon as we can, because they cannot allow any of this. It's a fault line, manufactured fault line to take us away from the wider issues. Hinduism is a faith that's very progressive. And through the years, it has taken care of a lot of ills that were there with the time. We do not need any outsiders to tell us this. Unlike other faiths, Hindu faith is the only faith that questions itself and that changes with time, because that is what we are told. Desh aur kaal ke saath badalna is something that a Hindu is taught. We are not taught any rigid things in life. So we are not taught that if it is 75, if it is 90 degrees outside and you have to pray, so you will go and pray outside in the sun, even if you have to do sun puja. You know, there will be a way for you to go and pray somewhere else in a different way. That is what Hinduism is. It's an open source book. It changes. So don't let anybody get to you about this caste system and all that, you know. Yes, there are some fault lines, but don't let them manufacture fault lines. Whatever there are issues, we can fix, and we have been fixing on our own. We have been solving on our own. There is no need for them to guilt trip you into this. Don't get guilt tripped. This is a very dangerous topic. Yes.
So, and I'm very happy to see, so many young people from UT Austin and others here. Is one of the issues that, we talked a lot about how some of this or a lot of this is because of other, atrocities that have been committed. But over a period of time, as to where we stand today, does the Hindu psyche need to kind of acknowledge its own identity and its own beliefs? Because others have very firm beliefs. But it seems like, I don't know if you call it secularism or whatever you want to call it, but it seems like Hindus have kind of forgotten who they are. It's very nice to see so many young kids coming over here and under this banner. But is there more that needs to be done to wake up almost what I would call a sleeping Hindu? I was just chatting with some of my friends in a WhatsApp group, and I just said, you know, it's kind of funny that if you ask a general Hindu these days that what's your identity, they would probably answer the question with, this is where I work, this is where my children go to school, and this is where I live. And try asking that to some of the other, you know, people around the world and see how the answer comes. So what I'm wondering is there something that needs to be done to the Hindu mindset as well, so that they understand where they belong, where they have come from, and what they need to do to move forward?
If I don't answer that, do you not drive me home? That's my husband. Yes. And, you know, when I was talking about this, remember I told you that I grew up in a Kashmiri-speaking household in Kashmir. So there is this civilizational memory that has come through us, but somehow my parents never told me about this. Story that I have told you today hasn't come from my parents or my grandparents. There may have been splintering of words here and there, but they never sat me down and told me that this happened. I should have known. I am the direct victim of this genocide. But they kept me away, which is what has happened to everyone. When Kashmir Files was released, I was struck by a video that came from Australia. A woman was, she was beside herself. She was just in tears and she was crying. And the camera went to her and says, why are you crying? And she couldn't answer. And a gentleman standing next to her said, you know, she lives in Australia. I have known her for 20 years here, but I did not know that she's a victim. So this has happened to all of us. We have learned to hide our grief and our scars in the process. There's also a Hindu psyche, which tells you to look for happiness and look for a peaceful state of mind. So we are almost constantly looking for peaceful state of mind. But when that was prescribed for Hindus, it had not met the Jihadi ideology. So my sense is that yes, we should look for Satchit Anand, we should look for constant bliss, but at the same time, we should remember who we are. Remember, and this is not just for Kashmiri Hindus. This is, the other day I was talking to my friend who's from Maharashtra and what Marathi Brahmins had to go through in 1948. So there is what Goan Hindus, how many of you know what Goan Hindus have gone through? 200, 300 years of inquisition by the church, by Portuguese. How many of you know what has happened? Does anybody know? I did not know about Goan Hindu till I would say 10 years ago. Shame on me. I did not know about them. So it is, we don't even know about each other. We don't even know about our own things. We have to formulate one identity, which is very important to rise above our regional, which is very important, regional pride, but we also have to rise above our regional pride and sort of build allies across the board and remember who we are, where we have come from, know all that has happened, and not because we want revenge. Remember, not because we want revenge, we want justice. And we want to make sure that this does not happen to future generations.
Can I also ask one final question, if I may? A comment and a question. I think part of the problem also is our understanding, growing up in India, our understanding of secularism. We all grew up, I'm sure you remember that. I know I remember it growing up in India, we were, you know, proud of being, you know, the socialist secular republic, right? That was, we were taught the preamble of the constitution. I feel like the concept of secularism, which, you know, I think for most people that understand that or will understand it as you're accepting of all faiths, all religions, all cultures, and you don't question. In my mind, I think we have to start looking at secularism more as a commitment, as opposed to sort of an unquestioned sort of state of affairs. I think it has to be a commitment where we are asking everyone to commit to respect and equity across the board.
Yes.
And when you do that, then question situations like this, then it becomes easy for someone who is liberal and who is secular to still stand up and say, this was wrong, it was done because there's a group of people who did not believe or did not commit to the idea of secularism. Yeah. And so I think that understanding does not exist in India still. Even, I mean, yes, Kashmir Province has opened a lot of eyes and has, you know, brought this issue to the fore, but I think that concept does not exist, and there are generations of
because you have to understand that secularism is at odds with a lot of faiths. When secularism or when democracy is at odds with what you've been taught, it doesn't exist, then there is a clash. And that clash will always happen unless there is a renaissance, unless there is the faith or the organization that they try to rise above, and some modernity is infused in it. Otherwise, there will always be a clash because democracy and secularism does not go with every faith. For a long time, it did not go with Christianity as well. But then what did Christianity do? They got out of it, and they sort of questioned it, and they talked about separation of state and people and all that in the way they understand it. But in India, you don't even forget about commitment to secularism. I wish there was commitment to pluralism. In India, there is not even commitment to pluralism where we are saying live and let live. That I will live and I will let you also live. That is not secularism, that is pluralism. Secularism is a much exalted concept. So even that we have not been able to reach, because I feel that some faiths need to, it is at odds with their faith, and it's not allowing them to do it, and they need to question themselves, turn inwards, and find out how modernity can be infused in, how modern values can be infused in there, or Indic values can be infused.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank